Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on the stage Chirag Patel from Net4Nuts, who's going to be the moderator, Ankit Chona from Havmor, Kaushal Mehta from Motif, and Pratul Shroff from eInfochips. Let's give a big round of applause for all of them. And this is the session which you all so want to listen to. So don't move an inch. And whoever's moving an inch, they're going to lose out on something, yeah? Hanji. All right. In the meantime, I'm going to introduce the panel. Chirag has been here. He started off the morning. Well, he is the founder and CEO of Net4Nuts Limited, a company specializing in providing mission-critical cloud solutions and SaaS, other hands of affair of Net4Nuts. He has complete experience of venture capital cycle, from raising funds to scaling the company to exit. He has spearheaded business development activities for Net4Nuts, bringing in vital customer relationships from across India, Southeast Asia, Europe, and the US. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got with us Kaushal Mehta as well. Just a couple of things about him. He serves as a founder and CEO of Motif Inc. He has over 27 years of experience in the BPO and software industry, handling varied functions such as strategic marketing, program management, sales, and business development. Ladies and gentlemen, we also have with us Pratul as a founder and CEO of eInfochips. He's steered eInfochips from humble beginnings in 1994 to being a top-notch product and semiconductor engineering service company today. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get started, and we are so very excited about this. Chirag, over to you.
Good, so it seems like I am moderating the most awaited session of the day. It's an honor to be in this such distinguished company. And I know we're running short of time, so I'm going to try and do this a little differently. I have a timer on the phone.
Okay.
And, you know, per question, we'll do 2 minutes, and hopefully the buzzer will sound and you guys will hear about it. But so at least that way, we'll keep it in check. And I think the audience, from what I've heard so far, is going to have a lot of questions for all three of you. So I'd like to leave some time for them. So without further delay, let me get started. So 2 minutes each, why an exit and why now? You start with Kaushal.
So why the exit and why now? So we've started Motif about 17 years back. And I think the question that we've always asked is, are we making long-term value creation for our stakeholders? So if we look at it, our investors, who have been Wall Street and Silicon Valley bankers, first round of funding in August 2000, and that they stayed with us for 17 years. Generally, you have seen the horizons of 3 to 5 years. So this was very rare. The second was our employees. And so when we started Motif, 22.5% of the company equity was employees. We thought that was the highest employee ownership of any company in India. We talked about value creation in the earlier session. This was a Silicon Valley style model. And they have been with us 17 years, amazing retention, about 300, 400 people with 7 to 17 years of experience. And of course, if you look at our customers, because of this service, they've stayed with us. So why now? We thought that at some point as founders, we wanted to make sure we provide liquidity to our investors and also make sure that the company is positioned for a longer term growth, even if the founders are not around. So that was really why now, because we feel there is enough management bandwidth that this company can actually scale. And I guess the outcome of this is that for our investors, we were able to generate an 11.2x exit on their original investment. And for our employees, we created about 300 rupee and peso millionaires, India and the Philippines, and very well deserved. But the highlight of all this was some amazing emails that we got from people in India and the Philippines about saying that how this has changed their life, tears of joy and sorrow, also because they thought things would change. And people who've paid their medical bills and surgery bills of their parents, loans, invested for their children's education, And really, that was really the fulfillment rather than anything else. So,
so me next? Yep. So why exit and why now, right? Why exit? I got news for you and for everybody. We all are going to die at some point in time, right? So you need to prioritize in life, number one. Equally important, I think if you look at any company, they exit two possibilities. Either you sell it off, get acquired, or you go IPO. And then you have to prioritize with your personal reasons, situations, whatever you want to do. I kind of started looking at it about 4 or 5 years ago because I kept getting the calls from the private equity guys that you want to invest in you. And I was not that much interested. At some point in time, I thought that if you go the IPO route, then probably we'll have to keep it for, if you go IPO, basically you are married to it for the rest of your life. And that's where your personal situation and strategy comes in. That's number one. Number two, you also have to look at the market conditions. Market is really, really hard. I think the money has been really kind of cheap, so to speak, for the last few years. And there has been a lot of interest in the market for the acquisition. So that's number two. Number three, you also have to look for a situation which creates a win-win. Like Kaushal said, all the stakeholders, including your investors, including the shareholders, including the employees, how do you maximize? How do you create a win for the people, employees, and the investor, and the company who is acquiring you? So that comes the why now part. I think things happened in last 4 months, 5 months. We'll go into the details if there is interest. But that essentially created a scenario where there was a win-win-win for everybody around. And that's why the why now happened.
So in our case, we are probably one of the oldest companies here. We were three generations old, 70 years. And I was involved in the business for about 12 years, maybe 13. And I believe the best value is created when you're not looking to exit the business. And that was the case with us. So what happened was I tried to get less emotional about the business. I think and that was something that took some time. And I was mentally prepared that at the right time, at the right stage, I would look at exiting the business or even professionalizing it, going the PE route and all that. And I did my evaluations and I realized that strategic is the best option. I felt that, so somewhere I wanted to give relief to my father as well. He had worked very hard for 40 years and I think it was well deserved for him. And I think the way I was growing the company was stressing him out a little bit too much. So there comes a time in every promoter's life, right? He has to take a call that how much risk, how much reward, right? And we had grown Havmor to a cusp where it was growing phenomenally well. Even this year, we are growing at 30% for a company which is about 400-500 crores in the FMCG sector. It was a fairly good growth. And I believe that, so the why now was because I feel that when a company is growing, when it is, you can see the returns coming in, you can see the growth coming in, I think that's a great time for the company to exit. To grow to the next level, the amount of risk and the amount of capital required, there is, as I said, there is, you start questioning your risk reward, and that's when I thought that it literally came our way with Lotte coming in, and it wasn't planned, it wasn't something that I had worked on for the last year or two, it just so happened, and they made a great partner, and I thought that they took care of all our interests, and it made a great fit for us. So that's the why now.
Great time. Okay, next question is for Pratul Bhai. So I think I learned something really unique. Maybe it was new learning for me, but a process that really worked for the company and its valuation. So can you just spend a couple of minutes and tell us how you went about this whole looking for the right suitor, getting the right price, and that process, according to me, was quite unique and very fair.
So I think destiny plays its own role. God has been kind to me and all the shareholders. That's number one. Number two, I think by and large, the valuation is always going to be fair. I truly and honestly believe that. Nobody's going to give you five times the money that you deserve, so to speak, right? But having said that, how do you create and how do you maximize the value? I think that's more appropriate question. Number one, all of us are familiar with the dating game. So you have to not play hard to get, but you really have to believe you are hard to get. I'm kind of saying it in jest. Number one. Number two, I think you need multiple bidders. You have to have more than one if you can. When you are looking for an exit. In our case, what happened was that there was interest in the market, and I got about four bidders. My investment banker called and said, "There, listen, you know, something is happening. I don't know what." But later on, I figured out that we had a story around IoT, and somehow the IoT was really, really huge with a lot of large multinational corporations. And that's why I said, you know, by God's hand, the things work out. But coming back to the original point, I think the multiple bidders is very, very important. If you want to get a higher valuation, I think strategic investor is also very important, as also private equity players, in my opinion. Because for strategic investors, you are bringing a strategic fit, which is complementary, and they can use their channels, they can use their muscle power to multiply and amplify what you got much, much faster and manifold. That's what they are looking for. And that's where you have the value also, because then whatever you are doing will also scale up and multiply much faster than you will be able to do on your own, right? So that's one, and that's external looking. If you look at it internally, in my opinion, two, three things are very fundamental. Number one, the top line and the bottom line, they have to be absolutely gorgeous. Number two is consistency. I think the either you're looking at a private equity guy or a strategic investor, they are always going to look for consistency. So at least for 5 years, you have to have the consistency in your operations. And the cleaner the operations are and more consistent you are, the higher is the valuation that you're going to get. Apart from that, my suggestion is to keep the eye on the operations, because at the end of the day, the value creation, as Kaushal mentioned, happens through the delivery, right? Whatever you are delivering, whether you are delivering a product or a service, the customer experience and customer value creates the value for you. So you have to keep your eye on the ball in terms of the value to the customer and running the operations so that that value gets delivered to the customer.
So Ankit, next question is for you. You know, you mentioned an interesting story about, you know, how you narrowed down Lotte. So why Lotte and why not a PE or, you know, some other investor? What made you kind of decide for them?
So it was a tough call to take. I think I just mentioned that it's important not to be emotional about your business. But it is very difficult to not be emotional about your team, your employees. And I think that is where Lotte won over the other the competition that was there to bid for our business. The first question, fundamentally, I would ask any person who would come and say that we are interested in our business, and there were a lot of people interested, private equities, even strategics, people with large footprints in India. But what differentiated Lotte was, so the first, one of the first questions I would ask a potential investor is, what do you plan to do with our team? And for me, that is where Lotte won, right? So they said that we are a family-run business ourselves, and pretty much every person I met from Lotte, that was their first job. Not too many people know about this company in India, because all they know is the choco pie and the coffee bite, but they're actually a $100 billion company, and probably one of the largest companies. They're larger than Samsung in Korea, so revenue-wise. They are into pretty much everything you can possibly imagine in that country. So they were very bullish on India, and I thought that they would make the right fit for us. Valuation plus minus 5%, 10% is always there, but they were very practical in their approach. They respected our team. And for me personally, I think the one thing that stood out was their respect for our brand. They respected that the way we have grown the company, and they've assured us that they will take it forward the same way. And they, on a lighter note, I'm not required to run operations for too long, so I can go out and start my new business sooner rather than later. That was a big thing for me as well, because after selling the business, as a businessman, as an entrepreneur, there's only so much skin in the game then. So that was also a big part of the negotiation for me. And so private equities come with a 3 to 5 year horizon. It's all about co-investing, and then they will come, and then you will have a new boss, and then you have to be part of a culture, which is great. But there's also a risk that is involved in that. And with me, personally speaking, I just felt that this was the best fit for us and our organization and our culture.
Great. So I think we are probably going to have a tougher time letting go of the Havmor brand than you have. No. We've grown up with it, right? Kaushal, next question is for you. You mentioned a couple of false starts, some good learnings, and somehow these false starts actually work for you. A little bit on that.
So I think for us, the biggest and the single most important factor was values alignment. So Parul and I, the two founders, we worked in the US for about 10 years. She was at Intel, I was at Sun. No work experience working in India. And so we said, this is how we are going to build a company which is values-based, you know, values on every wall. The founders at 3,000 people in size, we talked to new employees on their first day for 1.5 hours. Today is a Friday, Parul talked to the new batch for 1.5 hours in the morning, talking about our three I's, integrity, doing the right thing at all times, intensity, going above and beyond, and more importantly, intellect, challenging the status quo. So discuss, debate, argue, challenge, giving examples. Now that kind of a values-based organization, we were very nervous that if we partnered with someone, we in fact, you know, with in all humility, we had to terminate a India client because at a couple of points, their folks came in and raised their voices at our staff. And we are a people business. So we said we want to make sure we are aligned with someone. First, who has the highest set of governance. So we ran like a public company, ready to be listed anytime over the last 5 years. That was the way we were doing governance. But more importantly, someone who valued the people, and not just you know, on paper, but with their interactions across all functions. The false starts Chirag refers to is, so there were always offers, right? This is a company with zero debt, profitable cash flows, no second round of funding since day one. And we had built about 4 or 5 centers, each costing about $2-3 million just out of accruals. And our first round of funding was only $4 million. So it was very interesting. However, different factors. First, a German company came about. We thought it was all great. Then they found out they had to borrow money to finance this. And after diligence, they figured out that Indian interest rates are 14%. And there's dividend distribution tax, and so that went away. Another company started talking to us, and we were just a little uncomfortable with their management bureaucracy and the levels that we thought we experienced. But more importantly, the way they handled one of their current clients. So that was a nervous factor, nervousness there. This one is a public company run by their founder and CEO for 35 years. It's called TiECON, $1.6 billion company. So we think it has the right values, the right alignment. And in the false starts, apparently we are growing. This year we'll grow 30%. So our valuation kind of doubled at a couple of points or went up by 40-50% in the false start. So eventually it worked out. But what I wanted to talk about also about this alignment is that this company really offered what we wanted, which is at 52 years of age, we were not ready to retire. And we said, look, if you want, we wanted to build this. They have nothing in India. And so our arrangement is that we actually liquidated some to get some liquidity. But a majority is what we are rolling over and continuing. That real skin in the game. But also, we feel that this upside that we have, which we can leverage on. So,
Ankit, next question is for you. You mentioned it all of this happened quite suddenly, unexpectedly. You were expecting it to take more time, and you weren't prepared to a certain extent. Your parents or your father wasn't really ready for it, and all of a sudden this happened. And just tell us the story, how things fell in place.
So. The story about the deal is actually quite interesting. I actually was not interested in this deal. I thought, because every few months somebody or the other would come, some private equity, some, I said, no, I'm not ready. I know the company is growing, maybe after 2 years, maybe after 3 years. And there was a point that for 3 years, I actually did not meet a single private equity or investment banker. And I was busy, I hired some consultants and we turned around the company. And nothing was wrong with the company, but I just said that I want to run this company, that I'm going to take it public in the next 3 to 5 years. And then one day, this banker shows up and he says, there's this $100 billion company that wants to meet you. I could not figure out which company it is. I thought maybe it's Reliance. There were already rumors that Reliance has already bought us out. So I thought maybe it's Reliance, maybe it's Tata. I could not understand because it's an Asian company. But then finally I figured out it is Lotte. So I was very clear that I'm going to be focused on the business because this deal is a 1 in 100 chance that it'll happen. So for 1 year, I had given strict instructions to my bankers that we will discuss this deal related matters only post 7 p.m. or before 9 a.m. because I cannot get bogged down by this. One thing led to another, and you know, we constantly kept going back and forth, and I went to Korea maybe only one time and for 24 hours, and I made my pitch to them saying that this is a valuation, below this I'm not interested. And then obviously we had some negotiations, and one fine day I called up my banker and said that, and nobody in my company knew about it because I really did not expect this to happen. I called up my banker and said, listen, it's been a year, I'm done. And he called me up in 2 hours later saying, okay, there are 12 people from Korea coming and they want to close this out this weekend. I said, okay, let's see what happens. So they actually came down. Interestingly, my parents were, so we had obviously had seen some SPAs and all that, and we were negotiating back and forth. Interestingly, my parents were on a cruise. They were somewhere near Boracay. And so it's me and my lawyers and whatever, 12 people from Korea sitting there. And 48 hours later, we shook hands saying, okay, this deal is done. So I called up my parents. I said, well, acha, congrats, ho gaya. I said, haan, ho gaya hai. So they, my wife was also out of town. And so long story short, I told them, listen, you need to take a flight back right now because, so my father only asked, acha, paise kabhi milenge? I said, listen, it's a long way to go for that, but it's going to be in the papers in 48 hours. You need to come back, you know? So that's how the whole thing materialized. And my lawyer kept saying, in my 25 years of experience, I've never seen something like this. It is not going to happen. Don't rush into things. But that's what I said, that those guys were the most practical people when it came to understanding the Indian business and going about, which I was pleasantly surprised by. And that's, rest is history. So
sometimes when it's meant to happen, the environment around you conspires, right? Next question for both of you. Pratul, you can start. Both of you have had external stakeholders, investors, employees. Just share a little bit about the thought process in terms of how you build value for them, how you also incorporated their, their interest in your company and, work towards that.
Yeah, so I think with the exit investors, we took money from GVFL. I think the multiplication factor has been close to, I haven't figured it out, but somewhere around 45 or 50 times over a period of 20 years or so. So I think they are happy. Just like Kaushal said, we also have about 18% of the company held by the people, employees, and they have even better returns because their purchase price is probably much lower, right? So if you combine the dividends over 20 years and the exit value, you're looking at 50 times valuation, or for a lot of people, the stock option is practically free. So, but very good valuation and very good money. What surprised them was that we were able to keep it very, very low profile and very quiet for a long time before Economic Times reporter got hold of somebody or usne sab paper leak kar diya. So by that time, I think then the things got in news. But till that time, it was pretty much kept under the wraps. I think if you want to, this is more important, right? That if you want to build a long-term company, in my mind, having the participation of your key stakeholders, your employees, investors, if you have investors, and your clients is very, very critical. Even from the market valuation point of view, by the way, your investor or private equity guys are going to do a thorough check on your clients, on your track record, everything which is out there on the web, on the LinkedIn, whatever it is, you basically the scrutiny will be like the completely stripped examination with a magnifying glass for all the orifices in your body, and MRI and the X-ray. So it's a amazingly thorough, at least in our case, financial diligence, due diligence, legal diligence, and all of that, right? So the central point is still, I think if you want to create the value, you have to keep at it. You truly have to do what you believe in. Passion is going to drive you. I mean, if, this is my personal opinion. If you do it because of money, you're going to get tired at some point in time. If you treat that the money is a byproduct and you do it because of your passion, then things will happen. So in a way, I also summarize that, I call it my five P's, right? Passion, people, persistence, patience, performance, right? That's what gets you there in the long haul. And there are nine ways to skin a cat, or multiple ways to skin any cat, right? So this is not the only way. Let's be very clear about that. There are going to be ideas out there. There are going to be very disruptive business models which can get you there in 5 years, you know, instead of 20 years. But in all of them, I think these are going to be the common denominators, according to my experience. You have to have passion. You have to care about your people. You have to carry them along. You have to reward them along with you. And you have to have the persistence and patience to make it happen.
And it's not only the people who stayed with you, right? There are so many people who worked for eInfochips at some point in time, left eInfochips, and they've still been part of this ride. So that's a very commendable thing to do, I think. Very noble.
Thank you. Incidentally, they also become clients.
Yeah. I'll keep it short so we can take questions. So I think the only one piece of advice that how you build relationships with your investors, what I have practiced and I keep trying to implement within our teams, is really try to look at you being just the custodian of the funds that you have in a round of funding. So it is not your money, you are a custodian. And therefore, when we have to make purchase decisions, and you know, in a company too, it's when you look at investors' money, if the simple question is, if I were to do this in my own home, how would I go about? And that really simplifies a lot of things, that if I'm going to buy an air conditioner in my own home, then would I not want to buy the cheapest and the best quality and get a lot of references? And that simple mindset will help simplify things. So there is nothing magical about it, but just that ownership that here I am trying to preserve someone's capital. And our investors, we had seven of them. Three are large, you know, private equity, VC type, and others were colleagues of ours at Sun and Intel who chipped in along with us for a small percentage of the funding as well. And keeping this diverse group, some were non-interested, some were overly interested, some had lawyers and all trying to take interest, and some had the entrepreneurial DNA as VCs to take interest. But for us, we viewed all of them equally. If you focus on the business, if you focus on your clients, and that's where going above and beyond is, that 66% of our revenue comes from clients which are 15 years or longer with the company. In an industry where contracts are 1 year, renewals at the max 3 years. So I think that really led the way. Our investors had an open door with our investors and vice versa. And pretty much every single client was referenceable. So that was the comfort they had, that when the founders decide it's the right time, then that is the right time. And they invested in 2000 at the height of the dot-com bust. So we were officially their only investment on the books for many, many years.
So before I move to the next set of questions, how many people in the audience have questions for the panelists? One, two, three. Okay. So good, I have some more time. Okay. Caribbean beach, binocular in your hand. I don't see any of you doing that in the next near future. So what's next? Maybe a minute or two on that, now that you guys have exited.
So as I said, we've not exited, and so we have a few years, 2-3 years of full commitment as the company grows, and I think that's where we've decided to ride the upside along with this big company. So we are actually working longer, smarter, with more telecons rather than in-person meetings, but a lot of travel. But I think it's exciting. It is really giving us a lot of perspective of how we work in a large organization with similar set of values. And it almost got us back to our Silicon Valley days working in large companies, and we are kind of enjoying the ride. All our employees tell us that they kind of enjoy the experience. So far it's pretty much the office and the chair.
So similar to Kaushal, I think next 3 years I'm going to be with Arrow Electronics. They're going to retain eInfochips as a brand and as a unit. And if anything, they're going to flog me to run even faster, right? More, better, cheaper, faster, whatever. So, but one thing that happens is that money, it's a very liberating experience. Like Arjun was saying, right? It's a game changer. Now you have a lot of options. So a couple of thoughts. I think if you look at technologies, there are so many technologies which are completely disruptive. Business models, completely disruptive moving forward. And I won't go into the details of that, the Ubers of the world and all of that. But I'm very confident that something new will come up. That's number one. Number two, I run something called Dr. K.R. Shroff Foundation. We have gone to about 271 schools in rural Gujarat with about 407 teachers, touching about 20,000, actually 34,000 students. I think I'm going to press the pedal on that as well. And there are many other things you can do.
So for me, as I mentioned earlier, luckily for me, I'm not going to be associated with the ice cream business for long. I'm just in the finishing up the handholding phase. We still have a restaurant business and the fast food business, and we also have another small a startup ice cream brand called Hoover & Holly, which we will probably scale up now along with the restaurant business. It's funny, you know, while it is liberating and you feel good about it and all that, but now, you know, this is uncharted territory. When you come in as a third generation entrepreneur, it's pretty much given, right, that you are born to do this, and now you've come and you've said first, you come in with that whole experience that I don't deserve this, and then you're like, well, screw it, I've got it, so now I make the most of it, you know, and then you run it, then you try and master it as much as you can, and then you exit the business, and now suddenly you're back to square one. So now I think it's exciting times, but it is definitely nerve-wracking to think about, the moment I start thinking about new business ideas and all, it gets me a little jittery. It's also very important not to get complacent. With money comes complacency also, and trying to push it off. So I'm very clear that, you know, we want to get into, I kind of have a team already ready and thinking on new ideas and new stuff. It'll definitely be in the consumer space. It'll definitely want to start a new business, a new brand, looking at organic as well as inorganic opportunities there, and get cracking on it right away. I mean, it's, maybe one nice holiday is what you need to recharge, I guess. So I think that much I deserve. So
good. Let's open up for a couple of questions. Abhay, you had one. Can someone get a mic to Abhay? And Samir, you can ask your questions offline too. So let the audience, someone else in the audience, do that. Okay.
I can also. Congratulations to all of you guys. My question is, how do you value your company? Because I have no idea how to value mine.
uh, So I think there are standard financial models, right? I mean, from 2000 onwards, has been going to MBA finance. So there are financial models they build up in terms of the revenue multiplier, in terms of P ratios, in terms of the EBITDA ratios, and these, that, other things. That's one way to look at it. The other slicing, dicing is that what the buyer is going to value at, right? Because if you look at WhatsApp being sold for $22 billion, none of these financial models are going to work. But those are outliers. I don't think there aren't going to be too many of them. For mere mortal like me, what's going to work is that what's my growth rate, what's my revenue, what's my EBITDA, what's my NPAT, net profit margins, and then the discounted cash flow methods and these, that, other things, which is very boring, usual, tedious, mundane way of evaluation of the company. And that's what the financial guys and the, you know, like I said, mere mortals like us work with.
So I'll just add one thing. When you sell, right, you'll always think that you sold too low. When you buy, you'll always think that you bought too high, right? So there is, I believe that the real valuation comes from the story you create. What Pratul Bhai said makes sense. That's somewhere to get a base. But then the alpha you create is the story you create, right? So your company is doing great, fine historicals, discounted cash flows. That is the way you get your, how do you differentiate two companies is the way you run the company, the future. So I think it's all about how you sell the future, and it has to be a fit. I mean, today, for me personally, what did Lotte get? They got an entry into India. How much did they value that? Probably at the value they gave us. So, you know, that's how it's supply and demand in that case. One of the reasons why we sold to Lotte was because we made a list of the top 10 strategic companies in the world that could probably acquire a company like ours. And Lotte was up in the top 3-4 of them. So if today we would have said no, 2 years later they might not have been interested. So I think it's just about the right fit at the right time that makes the valuation.
I think I'll just share what Pratul said here. Essentially, there are a lot of metrics. I think it's really what you want out of it, which is the alignment. So first, there are ranges. And you know, if you have, let's say, a range of 5x to 10x EBITDA or 10x to 15x EBITDA, and you know, depending on your industry, you can always think, are you on the bottom of the range? Are you at the high end of the range? And you can easily know my company is doing, compared to the market, at double the EBITDA of what average company in the market is. So at least I should be valued at the top of the range. That was our simple framework. However, the most important thing was the values alignment. So if these very guys had offered us, let's say, 1x lower, we would not have blinked, because we said, look, long-term value creation for all employees is stock options of a public company. For founders, it is essentially staying and growing. And for investors, we wanted to make sure that we were kind of negotiating for them a complete exit on day one, which was respectable. So given all of that, we said, look, here is a decent valuation, which pretty much, and it was everyone of them was in agreement, all our stakeholders. So that was the other thing, that it was not one party happy over the other.
Okay, so I think we'll have to end the session here.
Sorry, I'm going to ask.
Only for one speaker, who had a question in the back?
Yeah, so I have a question. So
yeah, please, go ahead.
Yeah. So at any point of time during this discussion and exit process, did you ever think of changing your mind and not selling it off?
Sorry, who's the question for which of the panelists?
Either Pratul or Ankit could answer that. Yeah.
Okay, can you repeat the question? Did you get the question?
So at any point in time during this exit and discussion process, did you ever think did you ever had the change of mind that I don't want to sell that anymore?
Yes, all the time.
And why?
And see, you always ask yourself, am I selling at the right time? Am I selling at the right value? What if I do this next year? Oh, you know, milk prices are coming down. Profit will improve next year. I'll get a better multiple. Let's wait. There are some more deals happening in the market. So you always second guess yourself, right? And hindsight is always 20/20. But at that time, you don't know whether you're doing justice, what will happen to the employees, what will I do? Suddenly you start thinking, okay, what if the deal happens and then my life, my, you know, right now I got this thing which says Havmor. Well, technically this is wrong. I'm no more Havmor, right? So somebody asked me for a business card. I don't have a business card right now. I have to figure that. I have to make a new design for my restaurant business. So, you know, you start thinking, you start questioning yourself. It's a loss of identity. So all those questions do come into your mind. You have to just keep your eye on the ball and tell yourself that this is what makes sense and this is the right thing to do. Unlocking value for your shareholders, which is the family, and do the best you have to do. And I think you need a mentor, you need a sounding board, and that's what I did. And every time I had any doubts, I had a couple of friends, family, I'd go and discuss it with them, and they'd give me the right advice and practical advice, and that's what I took and moved on with.